Hello, thank you, to Elizabeth Abagli for being my ambassador and presenter, and at the same time thank you to the organization of this book fair. My conference is Women in Catharism, and it is based on my book Raymond Piquier, Heroine Among Cathars, and the Spanish version La ruta de los cátaros y las mujeres en el catarismo. Have you ever wondered how it would be if our history had been written by women instead of men? We will start from the freedom of the human being to choose and from equal opportunities regardless sex, race, and social status. In this historical and poetic study from the perspective of gender equality, we will see the medieval world through the eyes of a Cathar woman whose name was Raymond Piquier. Her name has gone down in history for being the lover of the last Cathar who was burned at the stake, Guillaume Beribaste. The human being, man or woman, whatever the era, needs to live in freedom and freely choose his or her beliefs. When the system removes both possibilities, freedom and the possibility to choose, from human beings is when heresy and revolts and revolutions arise. From here, our strongest repulses for the persecutions of innocence, the abuses against women, the Crusades and the Inquisition. Our life and custom with the Cathars, they lived poorly at the style of the first Christians, helping everyone who needed it. They made their living with the manual work. Each one had to choose according to his or her preferences and do it in a total perfection. The only temples they had were the body, where the spirit of Christ resided. It had to be purified with fasting and mortification constantly. They believe in the transmigration of the soul from a body to another, as did the metempsychosis of Hindus. In the Middle Ages, women are considered as simple objects of reproduction, of human reproduction, without any right, and husband could even kill his wife in case of adultery. Cathars, however, considered that women should be emancipated and independent. Celibacy and deprivation were demands that characterized the most primitive Cathar behavior. Over time, the Cathar believers saw that marriage and its consequences and accepted it. The same happened with the precept that prohibited to all food from generation, especially meat, which was only prohibited for the perfect. The Cathars were contrary to procreation, which forced the incarnation of celestial spirits. A poem, and this book is a mixture of essay and novel or essay and poetry. Now I'm going to read a poem dedicated to many women of all time, free to choose. I'm an outdoor breath, new and free, to choose the curves of my way, my ideology, my present space, life without fear, any my own destiny. I am a free human being, project of life, to think and forge opinion in my mind. Free woman without tortoise storms terribly, in my own chimeras I could think smoothly. I don't want to do good while in prison, nor have to do evil by imposition. I will escape with the bars of this cell. I will be free even while in this existence. There will be a place in this tortoise world to be able to live this sign of freedom. Women and men arriving at that destination in which no one speaks of equality anymore. The sources we have were not that entirely reliable, since many documents have been destroyed. What was come to us is not impartial, since written by men, mostly clergymen, who defended a particular ideology or position. For the Lutheran historian Charles Smith, Cathars means saucer. According to the Greek, Catharos means pure. However, recent studies suggest that it could derive from Keter in German, that means heretic. With this book, if it be reality, what Sappho de Lesbos predicted when she said, someone will talk about us when we are gone. With this historical and poetic study, we will try to give voice to those women like Raymond who remain silent for centuries because of a patriarchal society. Women who have been able to get into history for their ideals, not for their ideas, but they were treated badly by an unfair society. The poem is Quiet Soul, dedicated to medieval women. I grew quietly within sobs, while the gaze lost in the infinite, meaningless my poor soul alone, beyond space and time for me. We were simple medieval women, working hard with tired heart, suffering the limitation of men, by sad winds we were thrashed. For centuries I was silent, a simple slave of my condition. I lived the discouragement and suffered with persecution. For centuries I was locked up at home, living the slavery of appearance, pretending a perfect supposed love, trying to live in an open ocean. For all women in the Middle Ages, I will release our voice, our quiet voice, silent, sad, manipulated life, the wild world will hear our cry. We were never invisible or inexistent, imprisoned in an unusual destination, the flower of history growing repression in relentless stop of attempts. I was victim of ambition done by patriarchal society, behind the solid cloud of mercy, prey of corrupt institutions. I'm going to spill my female voice among the masculine historical subject, a judge of clear crystalline cold water from the source that gives off magic. Woman forced to silence with a destiny, a slave in a garden full of bad hypocrisy. Today we are going to release the prisoner of today. Our dreams of freedom will emerge. How women felt in that society? With the imposition of Catholic religion or society in the 12th century, marriage was imposed as a sacrament to control monogamy and exogamy. At that time, chastity was demanded in order to understand the sexual act only with the goal of procreation. Sex was not understood, much less as an act of love or mere pleasure for woman. Women became slaves to marriage and procreating machines. Raymond says, I never accepted that. That's why I joined other ways of thinking. This is how medieval women felt, a white dove among crows. The poem now is Flying Your Dream Rich. Flying with placid black crows, the tender and fragile white dove, every day she swam by the sea of stalking, before the shipwreck she escaped quickly. She was forced to wild hunters and compromising enemies per her. She showed up, wait, and listened. In danger she moved her wings and escaped. Flying with cruel black bloody abuses, the sensitive and gentle white dove survived. Removing her, they managed to silence her voice, never the firm and unusual freedom of her heart. Obedient man, crying woman society, a song of sadness filled the sound of pain. The white dove escaped and cure flew again, flying with strings, her dream was reality. We are creating the route of the Cathars. For years, the local initiative has been very successful in tourism and cultural promoting Cathars, such as the Pei Cathar, or the region de Lot, or the Camille del Bonsomens in the Catalan Pyrenees, which have served to generate a tourism or socioeconomic revitalization in these territories. Now the Valencian community from the Valencian Tourism Agency is promoting an European international route that joins the regions of Southern France, Midi-Pyrenees and Languedoc, with the large regions of Conde of Aragon, Catalonia, Balears and Valencia, in order to establish a tourist route and an European cultural itinerary. The poem is The Roots. Roads filled of dusty chants, over wandering souls hopeless, looking for hidden leafy forest, finding a clearing where to come. Lost souls and contradictory beliefs in a terrible lost world without meaning, dominated by cruel tormented abusers, selling his soul but for a piece of power. On ghostly routes they escape quietly and hear their tracks in their distant abyss, erased by the relentless passes of time, and is the day the Lord grins again. The meeting of the roots and the prophecy are the stars of a few poor revelers soon. They would be real against the new times, and with the ideas would flourish again. We are those rebels and lost roads. We are the relay of extinguished souls. For years we live in the grey gloom, the green and always the wood. The passage of the cattle through the Valencian community and Catalonia is important. Fleeing from Inquisition, they took refuge in Morella. The goal was to escape from the French Inquisitor, who wanted to exterminate them. The Cathars of Morella were integrated into the society and welcomed and greatly influenced the development of key economic sectors of the community, such as livestock, textile, Gothic architecture, and medieval art, promoting a notable commercial and cultural expansion of the Valencian population in the Middle Ages, in early Middle Ages. The journey of Cathars from our lands, they choose Morella and the Maestra to hide because it was a remote place of Occitania and with a mountainous topography of difficult access. And they were territories of the Aragon crown. The kings of the Aragon crown viewed the Cathars sympathetically since it was the king of the crown who fought against the anti-Albanian crusaders and could turn a blind ear to the Cathars. Finally, because the force of Morella and the Maestrat are lands that were dominated by the Templars or the Order de Montesa. The poem is A Community. To take refuge from the storm of inquisitors in that land of Templars where it didn't rain, putting our stalkers good new safe ideas in a small community paradise of love. Our elders living in those little places, unsure than some great new sages, escaping from the truth we lied to reality, for a while we enjoyed that dream. We were joined to our conception of living, a corrupt world that we wanted to renew, resurface the primitive goodness and mercy, living with lies to make people know our truth. A perfect great pillar of our community, from sure, determined, tender, no lovers. Our love could not breathe in reality, for me, belly vaste was an imperfect perfect. The nuns trapped in prison cheated, but for some lies that finished with them. Equal men and women were innocent and left this world alone, but in peace. There's a distortion of historical reality. The historical reality of characterism has often been subject of distortion in a negative or positive sense under diverse ideological perspectives. Some of them, as the true Christians or developed Christians, a religion supposedly advanced to its time. There was a certain equalitarianism as well, a perfect man and perfect woman. This did not respond to advanced ideas, but to a total rejection to the procreation. Exotic literatures have been given Cathars the role of guardians of the supposed legend secrets, like the Holy Grail, and has linked them in equivocally with the Templars and the Hospitallers. Later will be some legends. Success of the Catharism. Towards the end of the 12th century and the beginning of the 13th century, there was a boom in Catharism, among other reasons, for example, given the simplicity of life and the perfect heart, both in closing of food. On the other hand, they were against the collection of tithes, which were sometimes the cause of ruin of many families. In this way, there was a growth of followers in Catharism in several areas of Europe, Northern Italy, Green Basis, especially in the Languedoc, the consent of the feudal lords that were supporters of Catharism, and some of the women were prefects and followers of the Cathar faith. The Catholic Church of Rome, serving the boom achieved by Catharism and after the little success of his preaching, began a strong struggle to eradicate the heresy. The poem is Cathar Woman, dedicated to the woman in Catharism. Don't be afraid of me for not being real, a medieval shovel with opportunity. I grew up and knew the breath of equality and lived the dream of a Cathar woman. I support insults and intolerable infamies, and we were sorcerer catch magical heretics. We were God people full of love and pity, but we cried for being victims of destiny. In my time, I was forbidden to breathe. I could raise my voice and be heard. In a dream that then came on woman, we stand against that abuse of men. In that early religious and social crisis, the discontented rose desperately, caught horribly by a nail that was burning, with the nationalism as signs of the identity. Stabbing heresy for the inquisitors that talk about many legends and minds, our ideas dream and change in the world. The crusades kill our water in the sea. They bred for our treasures hidden in at night in a large forest. When inquisitors caught our ghouls to confiscate our part, body and soul, we were free women in the slavery, slowed down by helpless orders, slowed down by cruel crusaders. Lifeless, burning at the stake cruelly, shadows pretending to live in our reality, a reality that led us to our disappearance. The Cathar dream of equality and freedom will always live in us beyond our reason. I'm going to talk a bit about Guillaume Bellibaste. Guillaume Bellibaste appeared in Spain during the first years of the 14th century with Pere Auteuil and his brother Guillem, who clandestinely organized the Cathar Church in Occitania. This community was growing successfully for years until 1309 the Auteuil brothers were arrested and burned. After that, many Cathars emigrated crossing the Pyrenees to the lands of Crown of Aragon and settled in cities of Catalonia and Valencian Community. Among them, there was the young Guillem Bellibaste. The first meeting between Raymond and Piquier and Guillem de Bellibaste. Bellibaste was a perfect of Cathar's charge, a perfect couldn't have lovers. She did not want to turn to the dangerous Languedoc. Someone informed him about a group of fugitives refuged in a town of Torroella de Montgrí. Without thinking, he came to know them. He and Bellibaste met Raymond for first time. It was a love at first sight, and they were became inseparables. In that town, Bellibaste met his friend Pere Mauri, accompanied by his brother and his aunt Guillermeta, her family, and the perfect Ramon de Castellnou. The relationship between Guillem Bellibaste and Raymond Piquier was an open secret. Guillem was perfect and he had to keep abstinence. To hide himself in front of the Christian families, he made her pass for his wife and before his disciples as his maid. Raymond lived in Bellibaste's house and had to deceive the informants. In 1314, they settled in Morella, and from there he went to the nearby town San Mateo, where there was a Cathar community. Soon Bellibaste went to lead the community in San Mateo. In 1320, Bellibaste left Raymond pregnant. This was not allowed among the perfects, since it meant breaking the vow of chastity. Then he forced his lover to marry his friend Pere Mauri, to whom he attributed paternity, but due to jealousy, Belebaster dissolved this marriage. In 1321, Belebaster was attracted by conceit to Languedoc by Arnold Sicre, a secret agent of the Inquisition. When passing through the town of Tirvia, he was denounced by Arnold Sicre to the corregidor and to the Count of Foix, and Belebaster was jailed in Castelbó. The same year, in 1321, Belebaster was burned at the stake in Villerouche de Termene. He was the last Cathar perfect burned by the Inquisition. The poem is Guillem Belebaster. Don't judge me for not be for my weak human condition, nor for the weak that broke my weakness that broke my existence. Between virtues and defects in my position, like others, I had slave of subsistence. I was not always the perfect they expected, firm pillar and pain from this den of the community. I took my people to an unhard destiny, but I was wrong on the way, and I cried. Sometimes I was the example that saved the world, others I was the train that derailed my mean. I love Raymond with my hopeless soul, and I pray to the end of our flimsy dream. We breathe holding our air, persecuted, hidden our condition, broken by the fights of the Inquisition, artists and secrets and unknown shepherds. I changed my name, my identity and my soul, running aimless along the Roman roads, towards virgin lands to lie in their mounds, where we could live hiding our truth. San Mateo and Morella were perfect cloud, in a land of templars camouflaged shadows, enclaves protected by favorous winds that return peace to the desert of our lives. Temperance disguised as tolerance, Raymond hid her love of passion. We enjoy our ephemeral existence, submerged between the fear and prohibition. Stuck in the stupid conventions, how much damage I did to my beloved. Beautiful, she loved me without condition, sincere as the whisper of the dawn. I could create the iron that forced the wind, but I was weak as the poor human being. I don't expect great recompenses, but the sky written my message. San Mateo, my name is in a street, walking through the royal wall today. You will feel Raymond murmur when together we made that way. If one day in San Mateo you feel her love, walking at night next to the wall, you will live with me the warmth of my beloved, her murmur hidden in the shadows. The Belebaster's community and the prophecy is interesting. The word of Guillem Belebaster said before died in the, at the stake are interesting because he said his famous prediction. In 700 years, the laurel will green, the Cathars will return to earth. Moments later, his body was consumed at the stake caught at the country yard of Castle Villerouche-Termene. However, despite the tremendous pain, no word of regret came from Belebaster's lips. On the contrary, an exemplary fortitude that he transmitted to his executors with his eye wide open. Finally, a white dove went out at the flames and confirmed the metempsychosis or transmigration of the soul. Belebaster was the last victim of barbarism that ended in Occitania Catharism. There is a very little time left to the completion of this prediction. It will be in October 25, 21, next October, for the 7th century established by Guillem Belebaster. Cathars are going to be known because of writers like me and books like Raymond Piquier, A Heroine Among Cathars, o La Ruta de los Cátaros y las Mujeres en el Catarismo. The poem is The Prophecy. We disappear, decimating broken souls, with destinies that wed sad and poor, that strip us the human condition, burning the sun bonfire of Inquisition. Soon the prophecy of rebirth appears as an illusion the last moment, to resurface within 700 years, whisper of hope before death. Someone detected the words in my mind, the laurel of the future will grow green, and after 700 years without the flame of black, the catalyst to earth will return. Our prophecy gave us eternal life of the our heart, to so tender and white, men and women living in equality, when the laurel will be green. Perhaps it was true, or a fantasy castle, a lack of my memory or whisper. For this question, perhaps the answer is subtly written in our future. And I want to talk about minstrels and folk singers. We talk in this book about the relationship with the katas and minstrels and folk singers, as well as the country love, courtly love, and women's participation. Katas accepts the courtly love, folk singers, as something natural in and the idealization of romantic relationships, but there was a certain contradiction regarding the austerity of the katas. For folk singers, love was a spiritual experience, and that is why the lady to whom they sang did not need to be real. In fact, the lady had to be inaccessible because the goal was not procreation. He might not even know this woman. In the Middle Ages, there were classes. Folk singers were courtly singers and singer-songwriters, mostly of noble origin, even ecclesiastical Christian or Catholic. However, the minstrel had the modest origin, singing composition already written by folk singers. They came from the circus life. Maria Magdalena is important in Catharism, for thus Maria Magdalena is a teacher, a widow, connoisseur of the supreme love, transmitter of the most authentic and revolutionary message of Christ. Maria Magdalena was a source of inspiration of some mystics, like as the doctor of the Holy Church, Teresa de Avila, received spiritual help from Magdalene. The poem is True Love. Is dedicated to Maria Magdalena. Nothing strange I can hide in the immaculate fullness of life. Sorry. Nothing strange I can hide in the immaculate fullness of life. In my white hair only you can be, and knowledge and share of love feeds in it. The love live that is true, the one that they can understand. You are in my heart that is mortal, and I can never lose you. I advise the path to other mystics, deposited my knowledge in them. I was in an inspiration of wisdom and grace, source of spring of a way of living. Nothing supernatural I can hide, I can hidden. My love was, I nothing supernatural I have hidden. My love was sincere and pure, a hair sword that was given for the one who lives in my soul. For women I was eclipsed, punished in mute silence, a full passion and sincerity, motives of the content. And finally, I ask the question, what was the danger that led to its destruction? The most of the eyes the church was the Cathars refused to pay tithes to Rome, and taxes to the crown, and rejected the hierarchy and message that is they put in question the traditional foundation of authority and feudal society. However, beyond the ideological differences, equality between them, men and women, free love, or recognition, hierarchies or social classes, many researchers say that something else led to the church to destroy his collective society. According to this version, it was no ideological danger, but social one. Cathars would have developed an equalitarian society based on respect and worth. There were no classes to access to nobility, and men had the same rights as women. Cathar heresy did not threaten details of the belief, but the same strata social in which they held. And I finish with this poem, Pacific People, dedicated to Qatar. For a time we were insignificant ants, small people in peace and tolerance, but suddenly grey storms on the horizon brought us anxiety and persecution. We were peaceful living beings that only flew without ambition, but they decided to cut our wings, rip our dreams on freedom. What was wrong with being wise, men and women equality, both of them breathing the same, the deepest in the humanity? The black clouds were threatened, it stopped raining federal war. They feared Qatar were advancing, the social structure could be destroyed. Qatar women, mistress and troubadours, what can see the new plan of history with a new wind of rights and equality, living our lives in a sea of freedom. Thank you very much, it is all. Thank you. Hello, thanks to my ambassador and presenter, Elizabeth Bagley, and to the organization of this book fair of USA. I am Pilar Bellés, and this is my book, Saint Teresa Avila, Courage, Rebellious Spirit, and a conference based on it. A small, easy, and poetic tribute to the Saint Teresa of Jesus, or Teresa de Avila, on the occasion of this virtual book fair of USA. And the Spanish version is Santa Teresa de Ávila, Coraje y Rebeldía. On the occasion of the century, this book was written on the occasion of the 5th century of the birth of Teresa of Ávila on March 28, 1550. It served to scare away so many topics and manipulation. We present her as she was a great ecclesiastical reformer, one of the great writers in the whole age in the Castilian language, although threatened by the Inquisition, she did not publish anything in life. The message that Saint Teresa of Avila left us is clear. When I see her clean eyes looking at the sky, it's as Saint Teresa told us, go ahead, if you want, you can. Make your dreams, look at the oppressor in the face, and don't be afraid of him or her. Remember that nobody is superior to anyone, since God, we are all equal regardless of our social class, race, gender, or skin color. Saint Teresa was a woman fighting for being herself. It is enough to be a woman to take my wind out of the sails, wrote Teresa Sánchez Cepeda Dávila, a nómada, no worldly as Santa Teresa de Ávila, or among Christians, Santa Teresa de Jesús. She was writer, nun, mystic, doctor of the Church, Catholic Church, founder of Barefoot, Carmelites, and co-patron of Spain. She was born in a conversational Jewish family belonging to the nobility, and her life was a quixotic adventure against the persecutions of the inquisitors for free thought. Teresa of Avila wanted her nuns awake and brave, to look bishops and priests in their eyes. Besides, she wanted them read and travel. About biography, I can say Teresa Cepeda Nómada, better known as Teresa o Jesús, or Teresa de Ávila, 1550-1582, she lived 67 years, she was well known but little read. She was a bourgeois and Jewish origin and became one of the most important reformers of the church. Mystic, poet, writer, and great fighter, founded the feminine and masculine order of Barefoot Carmelites, today present in 5 continents, whose function is to help all this one in need in the name of God. As a child, she began to demonstrate her influence, personality, and the temper that favored her. She was barely 6 years when her brother Rodrigo and the young Teresa built a cabin in the garden of the family home to live a hermitage. She used to carry most of her pranks with brother Rodrigo. They wanted to be martyrs, and so they fled to the land of Moors, and their uncle discovered them and frustrated their escape. I'm going to read a poem dedicated to the character of the Holy. Strong and decided of heart, like a gold reef in the desert, like a sword that guards the sea, I flew and from the shadows I cut chains, I managed to stop the breath of the winds. With courage and rebellious spirit, I walked tirelessly walking through trails, thinking or reflecting freely until I broke my sensitive way. I broke my soul on the road, seeking justice and equality. I stopped feeling my bare feet the day I couldn't walk anymore. Full of courage and submissive rebellion, paralyzed but always full of action, always with quiet soul and weak health, but strong and determined heart. Teresa was a young girl, and at 13, when she was 13, Teresa lost her mother, with whom she shared confidences, devotions, and her taste for reading. In adolescence, she liked the game of love. Sometimes she read in the books of chivalry and fed her imagination. According to some version of the time, her cousin and she maintained some kind of relationship that led her father to enter his daughter in the College of Grace, with the idea of removing her from her cousin. A serious illness will force her out of the convent. Nothing is known about this illness, to which the saint only referred with the phrase, I had a great kidney disease, which I had to return to my father's house. During her convalescence, her uncle Pedro de Cepeda gave her the Epistle de Saint Jerome to read, and would make her decide to take the vows and enter to the Carmelites. After her, Teresa's life marked an era, because in a world dominated by men, she defended the right of women to develop their own personality. And despite the problems and insults, she traveled throughout Spain and recognized the work of women within the church. As a writer, she was exposed to the risk of being denounced and persecuted by the Inquisition, and she assumed it. In each of her writings, it is clear that Saint Teresa was a brave woman. The poem is I Want, dedicated to the young Teresa full of rebellion and courage. I don't want to be a bird submissive, no butterfly flying with the wings tied, imprisoned in the invisible cage of winds, like a green tree breathing with her leaves. If you lock me in a cage crying, my poor dreams are going to evaporate. I want to force my young destiny to the wind, and on the roads never stop jogging. I don't want to have false friends, false water friends. With an umbrella I prefer to protect myself. I don't want to wear my soul with darkness my hopes were oppressed. I want to form my new world with good friends as pillars, they my stars like altars, and it had no discrimination. She ran away from home twice. The first one was a prank with her brother Rodrigo, and the next escape would be not attempted. In 1535, before his father's refusal to grant his paternal permission to enter the Carmelite convent in the Incarnation, she would leave home to take the habits and make the vows, not without sorrow, and she herself related. On that day, when I left home, I left so terrible anguish that I came to think that the agony and death could not be worse than what was experiencing at that time. God's love was not big enough in me to draw out the love I professed to my father and my friends. Teresa was 20 years old then. The poem is... The poem is A Love Without Ties. is dedicated to the rebellious spirit of the holy. I was a stain in the shadows you love, comes to me like sunbathed in the dark. You were the water in the country without shame. I was in Teresa in the 16th century. Inside, your childhood encased in cotton. Outside, some verminate people. You, a white dove chased by crowns that never got her spirit caught. You were free and went and unrebellious, a rose that showed rebellion and courage. A sunbeam that escaped from its prison, as show its light and other new illusions. From this, you emerge a new bright sun, insect that live a free and terrible vermin. You look at your enemies face to face, and you leave your tracks all over Spain. You pass between the bars of Inquisition, Carmelites lived as buds in bloom, without fear or hunger, cold, men, or lies. You were the song of life and love without ties. And the options of a woman in the 16th century are two, either the marriage and the family life or the monastic cloister. This last option was about living in a community dedicated to prayer, contemplation and divine love. The monastic life was seen as the supreme degree for the woman at that time. Single women were lonely and content. Even if one lost her virginity, was abandoned because she was considered to have dishonored her family. Women had no chance to study and were denied the right to read. In addition, they were not allowed to participate at the political, legal, and social level. In that sense, Teresa was a privilege since her parents were fond of reading and could read from her early childhood. But Teresa was a moderate revolutionary who achieved her goals despite the vision of the woman she had in her time. She, within the great sensibility that accompanied her, was relentless against the path that was drawn. She was a fighter who faced the prejudices of her time. She talked about it in her works, Life of Saint Teresa of Jesus, and says she had a passionate imagination. She was fortunate to have the influence of a father who loved reading and that kept literary works within reach of his daughter. This way woke up her soul and intelligence. The advantages of being noble or nun in the 16th century Saint Teresa came from a noble family. The group of noble women were formed by royal princesses married to nobles, countesses, duchesses, and marquises. Therefore, reached great recognition. Among the tasks of a noble woman stood out organization of the control of the service and the work at home, care and education of children, being aware of the economy and the family in the absence of her husband, who was usually in war. All these functions were multiplied when the woman became a widower and there was a minor heir, because this caused them to acquire great social power. Being a nun would be another alternative. Of all power with a social prestige that it entailed. In theory at least, the nun was placed in a supreme degree of the woman above the married ones. Being a nun with more or less vocation meant a way to escape the restrictions of patriarchal society. Compared to this life as a captive of the home, the cloister offered with a price liberation from the masculine world. She was a woman advanced to her time. Saint Teresa was a woman ahead of her time and did unthinkable things for a woman 5 centuries ago. She promoted an order, opened numerous convents, and renewed the church thanks to her impetus and overwhelming personality. The Spanish saint of the doctor of the church, moreover, she was the first doctor woman of the church. Teresa received this title in 1970, imposed by Pope Paul VI. The title of the church officially grants certain saints to recognize them as eminent teachers of the faith and faithful of all time. She was the first woman. Now there are four doctors, such as Santa Catalina de Siena, Santa Teresa Lisieux, and Santa Hildegarda de Bingen. In total, there are 35 doctors, as Saint Teresa shared this distinction with eminence such as San Agustín, Santo Tomás de Aquino, or her dear friend, San Juan de la Cruz, among others. The title of the poem is New Winds, dedicated to Saint Teresa. Walking with a body so sweet, within looking back, always looking ahead, without breath in the polluted air of death, woman with no destiny, always forward, caught by the networks of repression, trapped between the bars of men, you move the threads of condition, following the designs of your heart. A shouting in the quiet air of the sky, an under reveals a building, in a dark world she can light new winds in the stale of the time. Saint Teresa was a normal and courageous woman who opened her way. Teresa first and foremost was an ordinary woman, one ahead of her time, since the women of her time simply lived and take care of the husband, home and children, and became that perfect woman who was the model proposed to all women of the world in that 16th century. But she didn't want that destiny. She did not want to be a perfect married woman, such to her husband, and without access to the culture. At that time, entering a convent was an easy way to access to culture, since women were banned from culture in general and could not access to university. Entering a convent was her decision. She was an action woman. The poem is She Stole Her Wings to Fly, dedicated to the rebellious spirit of the holy. I don't want to be always crying, flying amongst crowds and impossible flight. I don't want to be a captured spirit who has to steal some wings to be free. Flying with imposing crows, the faithful white dove fell down. Every day I sigh the pain and bitterness in the middle of that field full of thunder. I stole some wings so I could fly in a white world without gust of wind. I struggled to be a white dove, to be free in that wide world. Courage, about the fear of Saint Teresa, is synonymous with a female exponent of matter of Catholic mysticism. Let us think that a way of thinking and living like this in the 16th century was not without great difficulties and dangers. Many people did not admit that a woman were literate and had an active life or personal relationship as much less, and they were dedicated to writing. In spite of everything, Saint Teresa expressed her desire to write and her conviction that she has something valuable to say constantly. But the priest, always male, were not only going to read her the Teresian writings, but they were going to judge, review, and when appropriate, order them to be destroyed. Her beauty, and there are some anecdotes in which her beauty is the protagonist. Apparently, on one occasion, she was going to sign the deed to buy the land for a convent when she heard the notary say that for a kiss from the nun, I will be paid. Teresa turned her cheek, and the notary kissed her cheek, and after that, Teresa went out happily. Never I had a deed so cheap. There are no photos of Teresa as a young woman, but from her writings, she is believed to be very beautiful. With 50 years old, she will confess to a Carmelite, "Now, Father, that in my youth I had three kind of compliments. They said I was intelligent, sane, and beautiful. My beauty is inside. About being discreet, I never considered myself silly. And as for sane, only God knows. Beautiful in talent and grace." Dedicated to the beauty of the holy. She was beautiful in talent and grace, beautiful in the deep, of the her hair, beautiful in murmur of the wind and beautiful in the infinity of time. Her friends couldn't be her enemies that dance in her nice spirit. An appreciation rubbing lies towards a spirit that managed to fly. She took her reins of her new fate that didn't want to be tame. Her superiors quick in, her, in the wind and the vermin had to move away. She was a woman sure of herself. She was mystical but also could a cold businesswoman, very skilled and closing her real estate deals for the commons. She had a high conception of herself and she was believed to be called to big action and she rejected mediocrity. She had no doubt when she decided to take power herself with great scandal of her superiors and a lot of fear from friends. Saint Teresa of Avila was a power woman, sure of herself, that's why she succeeded. At the cinema, see the first, there are a lot of films about Teresa of Avila. The first film in 1927, Teresa de Jesús, directed by Arturo Beringola, Francisco Beringola, and personified by Aurora Bautista. In 1984, Josefina Molina film a new film on the same title, starring Concha Velasco, which in that same year, in the most extensive version, as 80 episode series, very award. In 2007, Teresa, the Body of Christ, directed by Laura Loringola and starring Pat Vega. The saint is also appeared in an episode of The Simpsons. In 2015, the TV movie Teresa, directed by José Dorado and starring by Marian Álvarez. The poem is Recognition and Fame. Like a candy for children, fame would be for me. My life is a total nonsense without color to succeed. In life, I'd rather succeed to live alone in the past, my soul being persecuted to pursue my luck. Fame is like the wind, blowing without concentration, at least without staying, but it accomplishes its promise. I want to have fame in life, breath my young courage, a few words with smiles that excite my heart. Her work, seen new look, beautiful and commendable, but the reality is that it was hard, very hard for her. In the 16th century, being a woman, writer woman, did not help her mission. Not only she was an example of bravery and rebellion and nonconformity in religion, but a writer who continues to fascinate in the 21st century with mythical works of a didactic nature such as Way of Perfection, Corpse of the Love of God, The Irne Castle, Life of Santa Teresa Jesus, written by herself, books of relationship, books of foundation, books of constitution, exclamation of the soul to his God, meditation on the songs, spiritual challenge and becoming among others. She published none in life. After her death, her work was published. In her life, she wrote several books, hundreds of letters in addition to her beautiful poems. Thank you, Saint Teresa, for her effort in giving women the courage she has in history. Saint Teresa wrote poetry only occasionally. She was inspired by poems and pastoral literary rhymes and he learned in her youth when she also read books of chivalry. Many of them are composed during long trips to the foundation in the Bergen, in which she moved to entertain long and monotonous hours. She composed them to brighten the life of the convents because she liked to see her nuns happy. We reproduce some of her most inspiring poems in Spanish and English. Nada te turbe, nada te espante, todo se pasa. Dios no se muda, la paciencia todo lo alcanza. Quien a Dios tiene, nada le falta, solo Dios basta. vivo sin vivir en mí y tan alta vida espero que muero porque no muero. En la cruz está la vida y el consuelo, y ella sola es el camino para el cielo. Nothing bothers you, nothing scares you, everything happens, good does not move, patience, everything rich. Who has good, nothing is missing, good alone is sufficient. I live with living in me, and so hide life I hope that I die because I don't lie. On the cross is life and the comfort, and he alone is the way to the heaven. I finish with this poem, Saint Teresa Ávila, dedicated to a big writer. A restless pendant row with her hair, some dreams kicking for rich ideas, a plant growing with her light and water, remember Saint Teresa Ávila. In the golden days, a breath of fresh air, a white paper pen of free will, confessors, men, inquisitor society, freedom can be stopped even by hellfire. Universal literature was at your mercy, an innovative breath and a virtue in all fashions, tired of walking at her day tirelessly for a world without the colors of repression. Illiterate, glowing writer, woman sighing for her new times, from tireless workers to holy Christian, justice and peace in the universe. Thank you very much. It is all. Goodbye.